Hello, I'm Mariell Jessup from the American Heart Association, and I'm here today with Mark Creager, incoming president of the American Heart Association. We're at the European Society of Cardiology in Barcelona, and we're talking about Hotline Session 5. Mark, this was really devoted to atrial fibrillation, and there were three studies that I think people would be very interested in. Let's talk first about STICS, which looked at rosuvastatin after coronary bypass surgery and the effect of this statin to reduce atrial fibrillation.
Well, STICS was a very interesting study. First, the acronym, Statin Therapy in Cardiac Surgery. And the study was really looking at whether or not rosuvastatin would reduce the incidence of postoperative atrial fibrillation in patients undergoing cardiac surgery. And previously, meta-analyses of smaller studies have suggested that statin therapy would do that. But this was a large study, much larger than the entire population that was included in the previous meta-analysis. It was over 1,900 patients, and they were randomized to rosuvastatin 20 milligrams a day or placebo. And the dose was started at least a week before surgery and kept up for 5 days following surgery. And there were two primary endpoints. One was the incidence of atrial fibrillation, and the other was evidence of myocardial injury by assessing troponin. Well, as it turned out, there was really no significant effect of rosuvastatin on these endpoints. It's interesting, 20% of patients did develop postoperative atrial fibrillation, and that was pretty much the same in those receiving rosuvastatin and those receiving placebo. And the troponin curves were the same in each group as well. So in this study, giving a statin, which ostensibly would have reduced inflammation and reduced the risk of atrial fibrillation, was not effective for that endpoint. However, all these patients had coronary artery disease, and it goes without saying that they're going to need statin therapy long-term anyway.
That's right, because it's a quality measure in the United States that mandates that all patients after coronary bypass surgery need to be on a statin. So, as you said, it'll be there anyway. The second trial was titled X-VeRT and looked at the effect of one of the new oral anticoagulants, rivaroxaban, versus the traditional anticoagulant warfarin as a prelude to cardioversion. What did we see?
Well, another interesting study, and we constantly deal with this issue in our practices, anticoagulating patients prior to cardioversion. And, of course, there's a situation where patients undergo cardioversion early on, often with guidance by PEE, and then other times we need to wait for several weeks of therapeutic anticoagulation, typically with warfarin. And even though these novel oral anticoagulants have entered the clinical realm, they've really not been studied in this particular situation, which is as a prelude to cardioversion. So in this study, which included over 1,500 patients who were randomized either to rivaroxaban, 20 milligrams per day, or to the to warfarin with a 2-to-1 randomization, they found that rivaroxaban had a similar effect as warfarin on their primary endpoint, which was stroke or TIA or non-CNS systemic embolism, MI, or cardiovascular death. So overall, it seemed to be similar. However, I have to advise some caution in interpreting this. This included 1,500 patients, but a power calculation that was done prior to the study estimated that 25,000 to 30,000 patients would be needed to demonstrate non-inferiority. So when you actually look at the data, there was a 50% reduction in this endpoint in patients who received rivaroxaban compared to warfarin, but it was not statistically significant.
So I guess people have been using these drugs as a prelude to cardioversion, and I doubt, though, we'll see a 30,000 patient study, do you think?
I think it's highly unlikely, but I find it reassuring. And for those of us who do use the newer oral anticoagulants, such as rivaroxaban, prior to cardioversion, it gives us support that we could continue doing so.
Right. And then the final study that looked at this field of the management around atrial fibrillation was called AMIO-CAT, that looked at the use of amiodarone after catheter ablation for atrial fibrillation. Many of these patients have been on amiodarone prior to an attempt at a catheter ablation. What did they find in this study?
So this, another interesting study, the AMIO-CAT study. The rationale behind this study is the phrase atrial fibrillation begets atrial fibrillation. So there was a concern that post-ablation atrial fibrillation would lead to more persistent or at least multiple episodes of paroxysmal atrial fibrillation down the line. So this study was designed as a relatively short course of amiodarone administered for 8 weeks following an atrial fibrillation ablation procedure, primarily pulmonary vein isolation, and then looking at the endpoint of recurrent atrial fibrillation at 6 months by halting. So they're getting the therapy for somewhat less than 3 months, and then the endpoint's looked at 6 months. It was a small study. It was only 212 patients. And as one might have anticipated, there was really no effect of the amiodarone therapy compared to placebo on the 6 month incidence of atrial fibrillation. But they also looked at several other endpoints at a 3 month time point, so just about the time amiodarone had finished. And those endpoints included atrial fibrillation requiring cardioversion as well as hospitalization. And at the 3 month point, as one also might have anticipated, there was a reduction in the risk of atrial fibrillation, again requiring cardioversion and hospitalization.
So are they planning longer follow-up, or do they think this is definitive for using amiodarone, or we're not there yet with that kind of answer?
Right. That question was not addressed in this study, and I think that's an important question that would require additional studies.
Well, it sounds like it was a great session. I have to say, I saw an experience of a lifetime today. I was in a packed room devoted to mechanical circulatory support device. There was Alain Carpentier himself, who has been a pioneer of cardiac surgery for so many things.
And in fact, designated a legend here at these meetings.
That's right. And he invented and led to the use of tissue valves many, many years ago. He presented his experience today on the development over 30 years of research of a total artificial heart using implanted tissue valves. There are actually two ventricular chambers, the enclosed pump, and two pumps within this heart module, and explained all of the background research that was required to arrive at the date where they were ready for their first implantation. The first patient was implanted in December of 2013. It was a brave and noble patient who agreed to do this, and he survived 74 days with no anticoagulation after the first month, and there was no evidence of thromboembolism. I had chills running down my back to know that I watched this presentation by this pioneer, and to also think about the patients that we've heard about, nameless, that devote themselves and commit to a clinical trial so that we can report out the findings.
What a wonderful story. And having the opportunity here to see him present this information, this novel finding, is just incredible. And it really underscores the importance of coming to meetings such as this, as well as our scientific meetings this November, where you can really see firsthand and hear from experts in the field, cutting-edge science.
A lifetime experience. So this is Mariell Jessup finishing up for Science News Today.